Good morning to everyone. Hello.
Morning.
I'm Cheong here from Bullard.
And I'm Hans from Mapa.
Yeah. So thank you very much for your time today to join this webinar. Right. So today we would like to run this educational webinar to share with you all regarding the supply respirator and also the hand protections, right, for chemical handling. Today we are very happy that we have a guest speaker, right? So we have a special speaker, Hans from Mapa, right? So later on he will introduce himself and also a little bit about Mapa. Right, so this webinar, it will take about 1 hour, maybe 1 hour, 10 minutes, right? So we will see the Q&A. So how many Q&A that we need to actually handle after the presentations. Right, so a little bit about myself, right? My name is Cheong Si Swan, right? I'm currently with Bullard. So Bullard is a company has been doing PPE business for about 120 years, right? Origin from US. So I'm currently looking after the industry safety business in Southeast Asia. All right, Hans, so do you want to say hello with the audience?
Yes, hello, I'm Hans. As some of you should be familiar with me, I have been with Mapa for the past nearly 2 years now, and taking care of Southeast Asia for the Mapa sales of chemical and mechanical gloves. Thank you.
All right. So without further ado, let's start our webinar. Okay, so I will start with supply respirator for chemical handling. So my presentation will take about 25 to 30 minutes. All right. So this is an agenda that I want to share with you guys. So hopefully after this short presentation, we can have ideas including of identify a respiratory hazards, how to select respirators, what is supply respirator, and also the common setup of respirators in the market. Okay, so let's see what is commonly found in the industrial applications. So the first one is dust. Okay, followed by mist, fumes, gases, right, and vapors, right. So this five is actually a very common respirator hazard. So dust is when you break something, then you can see dust, right. When the particle is become very, very small size, then it become airborne, right. So for mist basically is a chemical, but you know sometimes we pressurize it, then it become very small, then become a droplet, then now it become an airborne again, right? So for fumes, it's basically when you heat up a metal and then you cool it down rapidly, then during this process, it creates small particles, small metal particles flying around in your workplace, right? Gases is also very common, right? Gases usually is original form in gas that's stored in a cylinders, right? For our process usage. Then lastly is vapor. Vapor, very good example of vapor will be our gasoline. So the gasoline that we put into our car is actually one type of vapor. So it could be in liquid form, but when it have contact with air, then it will turn into vaporize and then it airborne again. Right. So from here you can see out of five major respiratory hazards, three are actually chemical related. So that is why this is quite a concern for most of us in the industry, right? So besides the five major hazards, respiratory hazard, there's another type of hazard we also need to be considered when we look into the respiratory professions, okay, which is the oxygen deficiency, right? So if you are required to work in an oxygen deficiency environment, then you might need to have a special type of respirators, or you have potentially your work environments have potentially causing oxygen deficiency, then also you might also take into considerations, right? So another hazard is something new to us, right? Which is currently happens in the world, right? So you see the bacteria and virus now become one of the respiratory hazards, right? So if you are looking for respiratory protections for virus and bacteria protections, okay, then definitely hopefully this webinar can be helpful to you, right? Okay, this is a very important information that I want to share with you guys. So if you are the person who is responsible for your workers' respiratory selections, right? So actually a lot of chemical in the industry, right, is actually causing a lot of, we call that damage to our organs, right? So one of the most concerned one actually is carcinogens, right? So basically this substance is able to create cancer in our living tissue, right? So benzene is one of it, all right? So you can see here, benzene is one of it, right? And it's also very commonly when they use to make lubricants in the industry, right? So of course, you know, you can see from the presentations, you know, there are many other common chemical in the industry. Right, sorry. The what you call that, the problem with chemical health effect exposure, right, is that you have two possibilities. Okay, either the chemical will kill you instantly, right, if you are exposed to very high concentrations. So if you are not exposed to very high concentrations, let's say you are exposed in small concentrations, but then you expose it every day, right? So this is another problem. So in the industry, usually, you know, workers are exposed to small concentrations, but every day or for long durations. So the effect will come after 20 years, you know, even after your retirement. So this is a very important metric that we need to share with our workers. You know, if you are the person who look after the safety and health, right? You need to share with them is that everybody want to have a healthy retirement life. So we do not want to, you know, spend all our money for the hospital after we retire due to all these problems, you know, health problems, right? Okay, so in the industry, we found that there are three major routes of exposure. So number one is injurations, right? This one, I would say, contribute to the major portions, right? Because the chemical usually airborne, so actually it follow in the air, then it's very easy for human to actually inhale, right? So the second will be the skin, contact with skin, right? So this one, I would say, is also one of the major concern. And then the third one is ingredients, which you actually accidentally you eat, the chemical go in together with your food, right? So this one is also one of the problem, but less concern. So that is why today we have we want to cover the respiratory protections and also hand protections for that reason, right? Okay, so if you decided to introduce PPE in your workplace, right? I would like to share with you that you must always remember this hierarchy of control. But before you think about PPE, please think about other methods before we introduce the PPE, right? So you can consider to use eliminations. Can you eliminate the hazards? Is it possible you have substitute something to replace the hazards, right? Can you have engineering control or administrative control? So after you have tried all this method, right, let's say it doesn't work for you, then you can consider a PPE, right? But you need to bear in mind that PPE have less effective among the rest of the control method. Now, NIOSH have a very good guideline for us, right? Let's say you are now decided, I want to introduce respirator to my workplace. Right, so this is what at least we need to know, right? So number one, We need to know when, what, and how much we are facing, right? So you need to do an exposure assessment, all right? So number two, you need to understand each respirator, the potential, aside potential factors of each respirator. Then you need to also understand all kinds of respirators, the design of the respirator, the characteristic of the respirators. And then finally, okay, you when you do a selection of respirator, you need to consider, okay, the factor that can influence respirator selections, right? So due to the time constraint, so I will show you quickly how can we actually, you know, identify which respirator actually suitable in our workplace, right? So for exposure assessment, the gold standard is you do an air sampling if possible, right? If possible, you get an industrial hygienist to do an air sampling for you. Then you can get a result of your air quality. Then you will know what type of chemical you are facing and what is the concentration, right? Then after that, you use that data to do a calculation, which is to use the SI protection factors of the respirator, right? How to do that? Okay, first, each respirator manufacturer should be able to provide you this table, right? This table also available in the website, you know, even in Bullard website, right? So all the respirator, NIOSH have already predetermined, okay, the assigned protection factors for individual, each of the respirator. So in this case, for example, air purifying respirator, a full face mask design, it gives you a protection level or assigned protections of 50, right? So remember 50. Okay, and then this is one of the common formulas that we use to determine, you can use to determine the maximum use concentrations of that given respirator, right? In this case, we use a full face mask as an example, right? So you have a APF of 50, right? And then you have a PEL of the chemical. Now we need to go to look for the PEL. Right, so for me personally, actually, I like to use these resources, which is provided by NIOSH. Right, you can actually go into the NIOSH website, right? It's called Pocket Guide to Chemical Hazard. You just type in the chemical you are looking, you want to search for, then it can pop up and give you all this information. So we need two information from this chemical guide. One is the IDLH number, right? IDLH, which is 100 in this case, and then OSHA PEL, which is TWF 5 ppm in this case, right? With this, we need these two numbers and together with the respirator assigned protections number. So if you put everything together, right? So if you put everything together, from here you can see, right? 50 is the full face mask PEL, 5 ppm is the PEL for the respirator, sorry, for the sulfur dioxide gases, right? It's equal to 250 ppm, right? So it tells you the maximum use of concentration for this setup is 250 ppm, right? But however, this IDLH, right? You remember just now I said that you need to also consider IDLH. So IDLH in this case is only 100, right? So if you want to use a air purifying full face mask respirator, even though the MUC is 250, but then we need to cap at 100 ppm. All right, so you can use these examples to calculate other respirators and also to assess your working environment, which respirator could be suitable for you. All right, okay, so you may come into the, this is only one of the considered factors, yeah. Okay, so there are other factors that you also need to be considered. For example, your working temperatures, your environments, your work, the mobility of your work, all this must take into consideration as well. Okay, so by now you should have rough ideas, you know, how to make, how to select a respirator based on the calculations, right? And then next thing, what we need to know is that this is all the respirator available in the market, right? From half mask respirator, full face mask respirator, disposable mask, BAPR, right? So all these are, we call the top four, we call air purifying respirator. So for this one, we call powered air purifying respirator, right? And then the bottom three are supply air respirators, right? So for today's subject, we will actually dive into these products, right? This product group, okay? Because some people call it, we call it supply air respirator, some people call it airline respirators, right? So let's dive in further. Okay, so when you require to use supply air respirators, okay? So based on the calculation that I show you just now, you might come into a conclusion that, you know, supply air respirator does not give you enough protections, all right? So in that case, you might need to level up or you need to look for the higher protections, PPE, which is supply air respirators, okay? And sometimes you might have problem to tell, you know, you can't tell what is actually in the chemicals, right? And also concentration. So if you have difficulty to determine these parts, then you know air purifying respirator might not be a good idea, but you can consider the USAR, right? So, and also some of the chemicals, right, is very difficult to absorb by the chemical cartridges, right? So even you can absorb, maybe the run time or the change out schedule is very short. No, maybe it can only last you for a couple of hours. Let's say, you know, 5 hours, 8 hours. Then you need to change your filters, you know, very often. So in these situations, actually, you can also consider to have a supply respirator, which does not based on filtration technologies, right? So another situation is that if your workers require to wear respirator for long durations, so let's say 8 hours, 10 hours a day, so I would say, you know, the supply respirator actually is a more suitable product, because in general, the supply respirator actually give you a better comfort. At the same time, right, it's also lightweight. It does not burden the user, especially there is no increase of breathing resistance. Right, so this is all the reason, no? Or all the reason for you to consider to use a supply air respirator. Right, of course, you know, the advantage is that besides what I have mentioned, you can also have the cooling and also the heated air, right? So let's say you are working under a hot sun, your environment is hot and humid, then the SAR system can actually configure it to have supply of cooling air, right, for your body temperature management, right? Then the tight fitting mask require fit testing. So some people having problem to actually pass the fit testing due to many reasons. One, the common one is actually the facial hair, right? If you have a lot of facial hair, you might have problem to pass the test fitting. So then in this case, you can actually pair with a supply respirator with a loose fitting helmet, then which does not require you to do a fit testing, right? So the other one is that the breathing resistance is very low and very comfort and also lightweight, right? One of the significant advantage for supply respirator is actually low operation cost, right? So many of a lot of people are not aware of it is that the initial cost could be moderate for supply respirators, but actually in long run the operation cost is very, very low, right? Basically the minimum, I would say there is no change of filter, no changing of cartridges, like, so in long run actually you save a lot using a supply respirator, right? So when we come into the respirator, supply respirators, right? They are two authority actually take care of this system, right? One is NIOSH. So basically NIOSH, if you have the product certifications, right? NIOSH, you have product certification for the respirator. So according to NIOSH, the respirator is defined as the head top, the building tube, and also a hose. Right, these three components, so NIOSH will have certification for it. So once we have the certification, then NIOSH will issue a TC number. Then you can base on this TC number to actually check, you know, whether this respirator are NIOSH approved or not, right? And bear in mind is that NIOSH does not approve pump or compressor. Okay, this is not, NIOSH does not approve pump or respirator, compressor. All right, so another body will be OSHA. So OSHA does not give product certifications. Okay, it does not give product certification, but OSHA will tell you, you know, what type of air is required to run the respirator. Yeah, this is very important. OSHA tell you, okay, if you want to use a supply respirator, what kind of air you need to introduce into the supply air respirators, right? So this is what we need. So before we introduce the air into the supply respirators, we must have a grade D compliance, right? Grade D breathable air compliance, right? So this is the parameter that are listed out by OSHA. So OSHA said, if you want to use SAR, the air that go into the SAR, it must comply or follow or meet all these requirements, right? Example, oxygen level, oil content, carbon monoxide level, carbon dioxide level, and the rest of the parameter, right? So in general, this is the air source of supply air respirators, right? So in the industry, we can either get the air from a cylinders, right? You fill the air, a grade D compliance air into the cylinders, and then you send it to the site, and then you connect to the respirator, right? So, or you can use a free air pump, right? Usually free air pump is powered by electricity. One, you turn it on, and then the motor will run, and then you suck in the ambient air and push it into the respirator. Or you can also consider to have an air compressor, right? So for air, all these three methods is approved and also commonly being used in the industry. But there's another requirement by OSHA is that you cannot just connect the supply respirator to the air source. In between, you are required to have a point of attachment, right? So this, there's a reason for you why we need to have a point of attachment, right? I will go into a further detail in a short while. So now let's look at, the advantage of each and disadvantage of each air source. If you want to get the air from cylinders, then it's a very costly method, right? And inconvenience, because the air, basically you have limited air, you can't last forever, right? If you want to go for free air pumps, and then it's a good method, but then you have limited cooling options. And also usually free air pump only can support a small group of people, maybe one, two users, right? And compressor. So air compressor is very common method, okay? And it's actually a good method. Compressor easily available, but then you need to take care of one thing, which is the CO contamination, right? Okay. Now, let's go back to the point of attachment. So according to OSHA, you must have a point of attachment consists of four components, which is a pressure gauge. You have a regulator, right? You need to have pressure relief valve and also compass fitting, right? Which is mean the consistent fitting, right? You must have all these elements in the point of attachment before you can connect the respirator to the air source. If you are using air compressor, then you must also have CO monitor in place, right? Remember that. Okay, so this is the common supply air respirator that we can see in the market, right? Compressors, and point of attachment. So if you open up, so this is how it looks like inside. So we have filter, pressure gauge, pressure regulator, and CO monitor, followed by pressure relief valve. So does it meet OSHA requirement? Yes, right, definitely it meets. Right, then we can connect the respirator, in this case it's a full face mask, right, to the POA. Right, so this setup is pretty common in the chemical industry, right? So if you have a different setup in your plant, for example, you are looking at something more permanent in store, let's say you want to set up a workshops, you know, which is permanent, then you can also consider to have something that's fixed in your workshops, right? Same thing again, POA consists of all the necessary components. And then if you need more than just full face mask protections, for example, you need head protection, you need face, high impact protection for the face, then HMSI, multi-purpose, SAR helmet is a good option, right? Chemical coating, so this is also one of the very common applications, right? So if you do not require any head protection, you know, high impact protections, because due to, you know, you are just doing coating, right? So CC20 loose fitting hood is a good option because it's actually very light, also very easy to use, right? Then in this case, if you do not have spare compressor, you can also get a free air pump, you know, free air pumps, and then in between there is a supply air hose, right? The air will be delivered to the hood, right? So same thing again, POA is all integrated into the pump, right? So finally, this will be the air compressor for setup for abrasive blasting applications, right? So from here you can see the difference between the rest. You can see the design of these filtrations is more robust, right? Because abrasive blasting usually is an outdoor activities, right? So it's a harsh environment, right? So and is usually is a mobile kind of activities. You need to go from side to side, right? So we designed the filtrations in metal housing, right? This is the filtrations, and then you have the rest of the POA, including of pressure gauge, regulator, and also the fitting, right? And external CO monitor. Then followed by remote alarm. All right, so from here you can see the sandblasting UVX sandblasting helmet, right? It gives you all kinds of protections, including head protections, face protections, respiratory protections, and also the cooling, right? If you decided to use with the cooling options, and then it will actually supply you the cooling air, right? I think it's very important for Asia people, right? Because for most of us actually live in the hot weather. Okay, all right. Okay, so now I will hand over the presentations to Hans, let him to share more with you regarding the hand protections.
Okay, hello everyone. Thank you, John, and thank you, Bullard, for inviting me. Seems to be a very nice special speaker from Mapa. So let's move on. As some of you have known me, I'm Hans from Mapa. So let me take off my mask since it's not very clear earlier when Cheong presented with his mask, but we are still maintaining social distancing and wearing masks. Practice your SOP. Malaysia is still quite serious in COVID cases. Okay, let's take a look at the glove, right? Glove is something you wear for your hand protection. And I'm going to talk basically the features. And don't forget, our focus today is all about chemical gloves, okay? So for any chemical gloves, these are the features that you should be looking for. Number one, what is the material? Yeah. Number two, the grip pattern. Yeah, the grip is important because you need to hold on to something that it's maybe wet, maybe dry. Is it slippery? Is it oily? Yeah. Internal finish, is it chlorinated inside the glove, or is it flock or thermal support or cotton base? Yeah. Cuff end, okay, at the end, at the bottom of the glove, it's what we call cuff end, okay? These are some of the terms which you might not know, but it's something for you to be familiar with, okay? Now, let's see. Glove comes in many sizes, yeah? So just take note that in order to determine your size, your palm of your hand, you take a measuring tape and take the circumference of your palm. That would give you an idea whether you are extra small, medium, large, depending on the circumference, okay? Now, take note that different brand, they have different sizes, okay? So in other words, if you are donning a Mickey Mouse brand size medium, it might not be the same size medium if you change to a Donald Duck brand, okay? So just be careful on this. Take the circumference, or if available, take the sample. Try on the actual sample before you purchase, because glove comes in sizes, okay? The second important thing about glove is the thickness, okay? The thicker it is, the less dexterity it has, okay? So if you have thin glove, you can pick up a coin on top of the table, yeah? But if you have a thick glove, you would have difficulty picking a coin up from the table, yeah? But having said that, if you are working in a cold environment or a hot environment, especially when heat becomes an issue, you need a thicker glove to protect your hand, because if not, you will feel the heat in a very short period of time. So that's why dexterity and thickness, it's vice versa. They contra each other off, okay? And then the last one is the length. The length in Malaysia or in this part of the world, we use inches more, 12 inches, 14 inches, 15 inches, 18 inches. But in Mapa, because we are a French-based company, so we use CM more. But it just gives you an idea. You can easily convert them, okay? Now, then we look at the cuff ends, okay? The cuff means at the bottom of the glove is what we call cuff. So why do we have different cuff? Because it comes with different safety features. Just an example, if you have a safety cuff with a strap on, it protects against the wrist, and you can easily take it off and put it back on. Okay, that's the safety cuff. If you say most chemical gloves, they come with either a straight cuff, yeah, very straight line, or some of them even a roll cuff. Okay, roll cuff is mainly you will see in disposable glove. Yeah. Again, why is it a roll cuff? Because for you to disposable, especially take it off, put it where wear it on again, so it's easier. Yeah. Chemical gloves, most reusable chemical gloves, you have a pink cuff. We call it a scallop cuff. Yeah. And we also have a mechanical glove, a knit wrist. Again, it's mainly to protect the wrist. Okay. Now, the last part is the grip pattern. So something is on the palm for you to hold the product, especially if your working environment is dry, it's oily, it's wet, it's clean, it's dirty. So all these are features of the glove. So it depends on what is your application, what department you are in, what section you are in,
Because if you're in a warehouse, definitely you are in a dry condition. Yeah, you move pallets, you cut the carton, you unload the cartons, which is totally different from if you are working in a workshop. In an oil and gas industry, it's very oily because it's petrochemical, it's oily. So the grip pattern comes into the play, yeah, depending on your work environment. Okay. Now, internal finishes. This is something that is inside the glove. So why is it important, internal finishes? Powder, we are very less focused on powder because it's easily for people to get allergy. Yeah? If you use powder, you must have very high skin tolerance. If not, most people will get allergy. That means their hands will show reddish, red reddish, or they become itchy. So that's why it's not advisable for powder glove. Yeah? Chlorination is the most common one because the gloves are washed in chlorinated water and then rinsed. So this one, you don't get infection so easy, and it's very easy to donning and doffing. That means take off and wear. So if you have chlorinated glove, it's very easy for you to take it off and put it back on. Yeah? Most chemical gloves are chlorination. Okay. The last point is reduces contamination. Of course, because it's like swimming pool. Imagine you go to swimming pool, everybody jumps into the swimming pool to swim. That swimming pool definitely chlorinated. If not, there are so many people there, so easily you have bacteria. Infection is very high. So chlorination in glove is exactly the same. Okay. We also have flop lining, or we call it flop. Yeah. This is where you will see there's a cotton fiber inside the glove. Okay, why is it there? Of course, in our environment, Southeast Asia, we perspire a lot. So when you sweat, this cotton fibers will actually absorb your perspiration. Okay, and again, it's easy for you to take it off. Yeah, go for your tea break or for your lunch, and then put it back on again. Okay. Neat lining, that means it's also inside the glove, but instead of flop lining, it's neat lining. That means it's quite thick. Okay, what's the advantage of this one? This is where it's high sweat absorption. That means it will absorb more perspiration. Yeah, and secondly, because it's thicker, it has thermal insulation. That means it's protect against heat. Yeah, so remember, when it's thicker, it's definitely going to protect you better compared to chlorination or flop lining. Yeah? Supported gloves will give you better protection for heat and cold, but your dexterity is gone. Okay, so just be aware. At least you know that if I want thicker glove, I have to forgo my dexterity. If I want dexterity, I want to pick up a small part, like a nut, a ball, that means it cannot protect heat. Yeah, it's very easy. Your hand will feel the heat. Yeah. Okay, now, so today for this webinar, we are focusing on chemical resistant only. Okay, but just to share with you, there are other specialty gloves. There are general purpose gloves. There are disposable gloves, which is the hot topic now because of COVID-19, so everybody is looking to buy disposable gloves, and disposable glove prices have gone through the roof, as most of you are aware. And we also have cut resistant gloves. Okay, but for today webinar, we are only focusing on chemical resistant glove. Okay. Now, this is just to give you an idea of what are the materials. Remember, we have gone through the cuff, we have gone through the grip, we have gone through the internal finishes, and this is the material. So what material are we looking at? There are four types of material for chemical gloves. Natural latex, some people call it rubber. Neoprene, nitrile, which is the most common one. You can see it's green color mostly. And PVC, okay?
So PVC is the most economical one. It's cheap, but then it's not really, it doesn't really protect you against a lot of chemicals, right? Nitrile is the most common one because it can protect against many chemicals, yeah? But the disadvantage is you can tear easily. So the tear resistance for nitrile glove is very low, very bad. Then you move on to neoprene, which is the second most famous after nitrile. Yeah? Very good chemical glove because it does give you longer protection and also better mechanical protection. Yeah? But then you have to look at the disadvantage also. It is it has low mechanical properties of unsupported glove. Usually neoprene, unsupported means inside the glove, internal finishes, there's nothing. So it's only chlorinated. Okay. So good and bad, good and bad. This is just to give you an idea of what is good, what is bad. Okay. Natural latex, Malaysia, as you know, biggest rubber producer in the world, or maybe the second biggest after Thailand. So we have a lot of natural rubber and they are good at making gloves. Right? We do have latex glove or natural rubber gloves, but then some people are sensitive to latex. Yeah, when you wear latex on your skin, they become itchy. I mean, there are rashes. So that's why not too many people are into latex. So our focus mainly is nitrile and neoprene, which are the two commonly known raw material in chemical gloves. Okay. Now, so this is just to give you a general idea, what is the best protection against chemicals, right? So natural latex, they are good at alcohols, ketones, diluted acids, neoprene at oils, greases, nitrile at oil, greases, petrol, PVC is only alcohols, oil and greases, okay? Avoid, so if you have these, then you try to avoid these raw material, okay? If you are in neoprene, chlorinated and aromatic solvents, they will destroy neoprene, okay? Ketones will destroy nitriles. PVC, ketones and aromatic, and latex is petroleum, oil products. That's why if you are into electrician gloves are made of rubber, okay? Don't expose it to ozone. Don't let oil get in contact with the rubber because it will destroy the rubber, the latex, okay? Now, we look at some of the standards involved, okay? So this is the, because MAPA is French, so this is the CE standard. So in CE, we have category 1, category 2, and category 3, okay? Category 1 means in general, kilang buat, kilang certified. Okay, that means manufacturer produced the glove, manufacturer owned certified. So it's category 1 CE standard. Category 2 means kilang buat, third party certified. That is category 2. So category 3 is kilang buat, outside certified, and outside audit the factory. Okay, so that's why you will see, if you go back, look at some of the catalogs from any manufacturers, you will see CE Cat 1, Cat 2, Cat 3. Okay, for chemical gloves, this will give you an idea that glove brand is produced by themselves, certified by themselves, or produced by themselves, certified by a third-party laboratory, or the third option, produced by themselves, certified by third party and audited by third party. Okay, so that's why there are differences between chemical gloves, Cat 1, Cat 2, Cat 3. This is just to share with you why there's a difference. Okay, now these are the common EN standard for gloves. Okay, so 420, you don't have to worry because every pair of gloves should have 420. Okay. EN388, most of you should be familiar. It's a cut-resistant mechanical glove standard. We are not going to go through that because our topic today for this webinar is chemical. Okay, so we are going to touch on ISO 374 or EN ISO 374. That is for chemical. Okay, again, we also have 407, which is for heat, 511, which is for cold, and 421, which is for radiation and ionization. Okay, radioactive ionization. So these are the EN standards that are available on gloves. Okay, you will see different EN numbers, and that will reflect what sort of gloves they are. Excuse me. So let's look at chemical protection. So we are not going to go through EN 388, EN 511, and 407. So we are only going to go EN ISO 374. Now EN ISO 374, it involves penetration, permeation, degradation. Puncture is 388. Okay, so we are not going to touch on puncture. And of course, we have the Mapa chemical resistance guide and mechanical cut. Okay, the puncture and cut is mechanical. That's why it's called EN 388, which we are not going to touch. We are only going to touch 374. Okay, now let's look at penetration tests. Okay, what does penetration test mean? So all gloves must be liquid proof. Liquid proof means that means your hand, your skin, your hand is not supposed to feel outside liquid. So the outside liquid, whether it's chemical, alcohol, ketones, are not supposed to penetrate the glove and go into your hand. Okay, so all liquid proof gloves must, all gloves must have liquid proof. Second is permeation. This one is very important. Permeation means whatever you are wearing, the glove, when you come in contact with the chemical, slowly the chemical will dissolve the molecules on the material. So example, if you are wearing nitrile glove, you put it in toluene or ketones or hydrophobic acid, over time, that chemical will break down the material and penetrate to your skin. Now, this is important because by the time you feel it on your skin, on your hand, it's too late because it has penetrated the glove. So this is important, okay? And then the third one is degradation. Degradation is you can see. That's why you can see visible. For liquid proof, it's visible. For degradation is visible, for permeation it's not visible because by the time you feel it, your skin has touched the chemicals. Yeah, so degradation is important. Degradation is where you need to know when to change the glove, when the glove is telling you that I cannot hold it anymore, I am degrading, I need to be changed. Okay, so this is all EN 374. Now this is how we test against permeation. So on the left side, the one in maroon color, yeah, you will see the chemical involved. Okay, in the middle, there's a bridge there in the middle. That's the material, whether it's nitrile, neoprene, it's latex, or PVC. Okay, and then the amount of time it takes for the chemical to break through that material. So is it 10 minutes, 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 120 minutes? So you get the reading 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah. Now, that's why this is important. When you, as an end user, come to us and say, Hans, I'm using chemical ABC. I come in contact during my 8 hours shift. You are working 8 hour shift, but you are contact, it's only 10 minutes, example. Yeah, example. You can tell me that I'm using, example, toluene, hydrophobic acid, 90%, and my contact time is 10 minutes. I would then be able to tell you what sort of material is best for you. What sort of material? Is it nitrile? Is it neoprene? Or is it latex? Yeah. You would then be able to make a choice on the length. I give you the material, example, I give you it's latex. you can choose the latex, whether you want 12 inches, 14 inches, 15 inches. Yeah, because you have given me the chemical cast number and the contact time. Yeah, remember the contact time is not 8 hours. I just share with you on contact time. If it's heat protection, you go to Bread Story or you go to Meat Valley and buy the bread. The oven is hot. Yeah, it's 200°C. When you put on the glove, you take out the tray from the oven, it's only 5 seconds, man. You take it out, you put it on the table, man. It's only 5 seconds, man. So remember, contact time is the amount of time you hold to the product and put it on the floor or put it on your tray. That is the contact time. So some people confuse it and some people come and tell me, oh, I work 8 hours. Yeah, I know you work 8 hours, but you don't contact 8 hours. Right? You don't hold the oven for even 5 minutes, right? Because it's 200°C. So when you provide the information, it's critical. We need to know it's 200°C, I know. Or even if it's, we supply to Nestle, Malaysia. They do frozen ice cream. So I know it's minus 10 or minus 15. How long is your contact time? That is important. And you don't come and tell me it's 1 hour. You cannot be holding the ice cream for 1 hour, right? So you only hold it for, I shift from here to here. If you are in the Toyota assembly plant, proton assembly plant, you hold on to the front panel, you dip it in your spray paint. Yeah, it's hot, it's 100°C. Yeah, but you dip it, you take it out, it's only 15 seconds. So you come and tell me it's 15 seconds. That is important because this is where we determine what is best raw material to protect against the chemical for the specific time. Okay, so not just chemical. As I've given you example, for heat, for cold, you need to know the contact time. Okay? Now, this is the degradation. Yeah, you can see that if it's toluene, latex, nitrile, neoprene, butyl, so degradation shows what? Okay, swelling. Yeah, sudah bengkak, sudah besar. Yeah? Hydrofluoric acid, no degradation. Yeah, you can see. Oh, no degradation. Sulfuric acid, 96% high degradation. Yeah, high degradation. So if you are sulfuric acid, actually, you should be using butyl gloves. Just to give you an idea that you can see my butyl glove or fluoroelastoma. Yeah. If you are hydrochloric acid, you should be using neoprene or even nitrile or even natural latex. All this doesn't show any degradation. Yeah. So that means they are good. Any of this raw material can be used to protect against hydrochloric acid, 35%. Yeah. Okay. This is where you can see a lot on your catalog or even the data sheet, MSDS brochure for any type of gloves. Any type of gloves, you can see all this available. Yeah. So it's EN ISO 374-1 with the test tube. Yeah. And then at the bottom, there's the alphabet BKL. So BKL stands for, you can see on the chart there, it's acetone, sodium hydroxide, and sulfuric acid. Okay. Now, take note, BKL is only 3-digit. It doesn't mean this glove with this logo can only protect 3 chemicals. No, it doesn't mean that. Okay. It means that these 3 chemicals can be best protected with this glove. Okay. Another thing is, if you look at the standard, yeah, the standard, sometimes you will, you will see this. Okay. There's a type A, type B, type C. Yeah. On the right hand side, if you have a pair of glove, chemical glove in front of you, you can see if it's type A, it can withstand minimum. You can see the word at least 6 chemicals for over 30 minutes. Yeah. BTT means breakthrough time. the amount of time it takes for the chemical to break through the material, right? So remember, if it's only six, it doesn't mean that out of the list, there are so many, I only protect six. No, it doesn't mean that. It means I can best be used for the six, but I can definitely protect more than six. That's why it says minimum at least six. If it's type B, it's three. Minimum three above 30 minutes. If it's type C, it's one. Minimum one only. Yeah. Breakthrough time is more than 10 minutes. So breakthrough time is very important. Remember the oven example I gave you. Whenever you try to ask us to help, I need a glove to protect against this chemical. I need the contact time. Without knowing the contact time, I would not be able to give you a proper advice. Okay. This is a very popular MAPA model, which I share with you. This is, you can download from the MAPA website. It's mapa-pro.com. This one is, as you can see here, just an example, EN388, which some of you are familiar from the pictogram. And then you can see it's type A. Yeah, type A means what? Remember, six chemicals minimum above 30 minutes. Yeah, so six chemicals above 30 minutes. And then it's CE Cat 3. Remember what is CE Cat 3 now? Factory produced, third party audit, and third party certified and factory audit. That is Cat 3. So that means MAPA has this glove, Cat 3, this glove, type A, ISO 374-1, and EN388, I'm sure some of you are familiar, which I don't have to explain. It's the mechanical glove. Okay. This one, all this information, you can find it from the web, from MAPA website. This is a neoprene glove from MAPA, which is also a very popular model, heavily used in many countries across Southeast Asia. So you can see here, EN388, same thing. Yeah, Cat 3, CE, six alphabets at the bottom. This is type A, 374. Okay, so again, if you need to find this detail, you can go straight to mapa-pro.com website and you can download from it. Just a word of caution, If you go to the MAPA website, they will give you two choices. You want to stay in the European side, English version, or you can choose whichever country that you want to be associated with. My advice to you, try to stick to the European side, English version, okay? European side, preferably France, but you can choose English. It doesn't have to be French. Because when you go to the US website, of course you choose English definitely, some of the model numbers are not the same. So in other words, in France, it's known as a different number. Just an example, right? Some of you which are familiar, 517, Trionic 517 in France is known as Trionic 517. In the US, if you go to the US website and you put in 517, it doesn't recognize. It's known as E, England 194. Okay, they are the same thing. They are made in the MAPA factory in Ipoh. It's just that in the US, it's known as E194. In Europe, it's 517. Because we are in Southeast Asia, we tend to follow Europe because MAPA is French. So that's why we tend to go 517. So when you go to the website, try to stick to European website, put in the three digits. Yeah, put in the three digits. It should give you the information as what I'm showing you here. Ultra Neo 450. Okay. Okay, so that's the end of my presentation.
Okay, so Before we end the webinar, so just a little bit of additional information for you. So you require a demonstration of product training. So by all means, just drop an email or call us up. No, we are more than happy to provide you the service and also support, right? So of course, we will continue to have more educational webinars in the near future, right? There will be one is talking about cancer mitigations for firefighter, and followed by personal productive equipments, right? So if you, I will encourage you to actually register for this webinar, right? Okay, so thank you very much.
Okay.
So hope to see you guys again in the near future.
Yeah, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.